That's okay. Okay, so thanks for the introduction, Dario. And so this talk is once again a talk about pseudorandom function, and this is a joint work with Michel Abdallah and Fabrice Benamouda. So pseudorandom functions were introduced by Gottreich, Goldwasser, and Micali in 1986, and so this is one of the most fundamental primitive in cryptography, and probably also one of the simplest. So a pseudorandom function is simply a keyed function from a domain D to a range R, which is efficiently computable and which is indistinguishable from a random function from D to R. So the construction by the first construction given by Gottreich et al. Was very elegant, but was a bit inefficient and not very efficient. And in 1997, Naur and Weigel proposed the first number theoretic pseudorandom function based on the DDH assumption. And the construction was is the following. So you have a key space which is zp to the n, an input which is a bit string of length n, and the range is a cyclic prime order group of order p. And the output of the pseudorandom function on with the key a and an input x is simply the exponentiation of a random generator to the product of the ai such that xi is equal to 1. So to ease the notation a bit, I'm going to use the following notation. So when I write something into bracket, this means that this is a random generator g raised to the power of what is in the bracket. So if we look a bit more carefully to the narrow angle pseudorandom function, what we can see actually is that this is just the evaluation of multivariate polynomials, which depends on the input x, and on the point which is the key a. So actually, if we look a bit at the construction also, the fact that we can see is that this family of polynomials is a family of linearly independent polynomials. And the other fact is that actually, if we look at other constructions, such as the Bonnet et al. Construction and also the Lukowatos construction, for instance, then these constructions have also the same kind of structure. So the question we address in this paper is the following. Given a function which is defined as, whose outputs are defined as the evaluation of a multivariate polynomials on the key A, then is this function a pseudorandom function if and only if the family of multilinear polynomials is a family of linearly independent multilinear polynomials, multivariate polynomials, sorry. So this is a question, and of course the question is on which assumption do we base the security, because this is clearly true in the generic group model, so what we want to show is that this is actually true under standard assumption. So this is the question we address, and so I'm going to explain a bit why we are interested in such kind of equivalence, and I'm going to explain the high-level idea of the proof, and after I'm going to give some application and also show a new algebraic framework for rigid key security. Okay, so let's start with motivations. So the first motivation, which is pretty obvious and which is already what I said almost, is that if we define a function which, as I already explained, then this is a pseudorandom function if and only if the family of polynomials which is associated to the outputs of the function is a family of linearly independent polynomials. So for instance, if we look at the narrow angle PRF, to prove the security, it is sufficient to just see that the corresponding family of polynomials are linearly independent. So this is very, 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 very simple. This is just one line. So this is the first motivation, but I think the more interesting motivation is the following. This is for rigid key security. And so rigid key security are an extension of the standard security notion, security model, where the adversary is a bit more powerful in the sense that the adversary can not only query the pseudorandom function with adaptive inputs, queries, but also can modify the key by applying function to the key. And so it was formalized by Bellara and Kono in 2003, and in 2003, they also, in this the same paper, they also proved that it's impossible to build pseudorandom function that are secure against an adversary that can apply any function to the key. So the goal in rigid key security is the following. We want to build constructions that are secure for the adversary which is the more powerful possible, so for the largest possible classes. But we know that it's not possible for any class, for any function. So why this equivalence is now interesting for proving rigid key security for pseudorandom function, if we consider a pseudorandom function which is defined as already introduced by a family of multivariate polynomials, and if the function that the adversary can apply to the key are also multivariate polynomials, then the output of these queries with related keys and inputs chosen by the adversary are just the group elements whose discrete logarithm is the evaluation of Px composed with phi on the key A. And what happens is that this value is indistinguishable from a random group element if and only if the family, corresponding family of multivariate polynomials is a family of linearly independent multivariate polynomials. Okay, so using this, we can prove some new results. I'm going to go back on this later, but we can not only just obtain all the results that was obtained before in related key security for this kind of pseudorandom function, but also we can create new construction for new classes. For instance, the classes where the adversary is able to permute component of the key. Okay, so this was for the motivation, and now let's go back to this equivalence. So the first thing I'm going to show is maybe the most simple way of this equivalence is that for having a pseudorandom function defined as follows, it is necessary that the polynomials are linearly independent. So we can do this by contradiction. This is pretty simple. Let us assume that there is a relation between the polynomials that define the output of the pseudorandom function. Then this relation carries on in the real world, while it does not in the random world. So this is clearly a necessary condition. So the sense that is maybe a more interesting and more surprising is this, the fact that this is actually a sufficient condition to obtain a pseudorandom function under standard assumption. So how do we prove this in the paper? We introduce the following new security notion, which we call LIP security notion, which is where LIP stands for linearly independent polynomial security. And this security notion is defined by the two following words. In both worlds, the adversary is able to query an oracle with a linearly independent multivariate polynomials. And in the real world, the adversary gets the group element whose discrete logarithm is the evaluation of the multivariate polynomial in A, while in the random world, the adversary just gets random group elements. And so what we prove in the paper is actually that these two worlds are computationally indistinguishable under standard assumption. So for this talk, I'm going to focus on the simplest case, I'd say. So I'm going to assume that the adversary makes linearly independent multivariate polynomial query, but the polynomials are multilinear, so they are degree at most one in each indeterminate. And what I'm going to prove is that these two worlds in this case are indistinguishable under the DDH assumption. Okay, so I'm going to start with a very simple case. I'm going to assume that the number of the key length is 3, so there is a 3 indeterminate. And I'm going to just assume that the adversary makes queries which are monomials. So this is exactly the family of polynomials which define the narrow angle pseudorandom function. And then we can see the evaluation of these polynomials, these monomials, as a path through a binary tree, where the root of the tree is a random generator. And if xi is equal to I at level I, you go on the right and you raise the generator to ai. And if xi is equal to 0, you don't change the value. So you do this for each level. And at the end, you get the leaves, which corresponds to the evaluation of all the monomials. OK. So for instance, for monomial t1 times t3, you go on the left, on the right at the beginning because xi is equal to 1, on the left and on the right. Okay, so what I want to show is that the leaves are indistinguishable from random group elements. So this is once again exactly what is done in the proof of security of narrow angle. So what we are going to do is we do some hybrid proof, and we are going to change the level of this tree by random group elements. So the first level, the root and the first level are clearly indistinguishable from random value because the generator is random and A1 is random. So I'm going to put in arrange the values which are random and in green which are the values which are computed as correctly. And so now we want to change the second level of the tree. So we get three values which are already completely random, the generator, the A2 and alpha, and the only value which is not random is the last one, which is alpha times A2, and this is actually exactly saying that this is indistinguishable from a random value, it's just the DDH assumption. So clearly the second level is also indistinguishable from random. And for the last level, we do once again the same thing, but now we have three DDH tuple, beta times A3, alpha times A3, and gamma times A3, and this is indistinguishable under the DDH assumption using the random self-reducibility. So this perfectly works. So what we just show is that these evaluation of monomials are indistinguishable from random group elements under the DDH assumption. So how do we use this to prove the general case? If we, to simulate a multilinear polynomial, now we just expand this multilinear polynomial we just expand everything, and we replace all the monomials by the corresponding monomial, and this is indistinguishable under the DDH assumption from the computation where everything is random, and because the polynomial queried by the adversary are linearly independent, the value are indistinguishable from truly random value. So this works perfectly. The problem is that to expand and compute the polynomial, to simulate the polynomials, you have to simulate up to 2 to the n monomials, because you have to up to 2 to the n monomials in for multilinear polynomials. And then you get an exponential time reduction. So this is not how we do in the paper, but I don't have really the time to explain how we do in the paper. The main idea is to be lazy. We use lazy simulation. And I think this is the most interesting part of the paper, but I don't have the time to present it, so. So what I just explained is that these two worlds are indistinguishable under the DDH assumption if the polynomial squared are multilinear. And actually, in the paper, we prove a bit more than this. We prove that much more than this, actually. The polynomials don't have to be multilinear. They can be any degree. And we also prove this if the key is not only just a vector in ZP to the N, but a vector also of matrices, which allows us to handle cases of pseudorandom functions, such as the D-lin-based pseudorandom function or the K-lin-based pseudorandom function. So, and once again, we got a polynomial time proof. Okay, so what about the application of this statement? So once again, we get the basic application to show very simple proofs for pseudorandom function, and we got the application to prove the related key security for pseudorandom function. But so the equivalence I've written here is actually a very strong the condition that Px composed with phi is a family of linearly independent polynomials is actually a very strong condition. Why is that? If we look, for instance, at the following very simple class of function, where the adversary is able to add any constant to the component of the key, and if we consider the narrow angle pseudorandom function, then this condition is actually not true. There is a relation with, for instance, just three queries. So actually, this condition allows us to prove security for very simple classes, but not for not so so complicated classes already. So the idea to overcome this issue is to use the same kind of idea that was used by Bellary and Cash in 2010. And the idea is that actually this pseudorandom function for this kind of classes is actually secure if the adversary is unique input, meaning that if the adversary is not able to query twice the same input x, even with different key deriving function, then this construction is already secure. So the solution to build a related key secure secure pseudorandom function is to force the adversary to be unique input. So how do we do this? The intuition to do this is the following. Instead of compute, when the adversary queries an input X, instead of computing the output using this input X, we use a new input, which is computed as the output of a collision resistant hash function, whose inputs are the key A and the input X. And what does this change? The thing is that if the adversary makes a new input, so either the function change or the input change, so either the key change or the input change, so A or X will change, and so the output of the hash function will be different. So the adversary always, the values which are output are always computed using a different input. So the thing is that if we use directly this construction, it's not really clear how to prove anything because A is not known, so we don't really know how to compute the hash values because we don't know A. So this was already something that has been overcome in the paper about Beller and Cash in 2010, and the idea was to use something called the key fingerprint, which is a set of inputs such that the output of the pseudonym function uniquely define the key. But here we can do something which is much more simple. Instead of using the key A as input of the hash function, what we can do is use the group elements whose discrete logarithm are the component of the key. So the group element whose discrete logarithm is A1 until the group element whose discrete logarithm is An. And the thing which is really nice is that actually using this, we can reduce the security directly to the leap security notion, which is the new security we have introduced. So the proof is actually very simple. If we want to simulate a query to give to the adversary, we just query all the polynomials T1 until Tn to get the input of the hash function. We compute the hash value and we query the polynomial corresponding to the output of the function. And what happens now is that these outputs are indistinguishable from random outputs if and only if the corresponding polynomials are linearly independent. But now the family is much smaller because the inputs are always distinct. And this is actually very simple to design pseudorandom functions which are now rigid key secure using this framework. So let me conclude with this. So in this paper, we define a new algebraic framework for pseudorandom function and for rigid key secure pseudorandom function. And it has the properties to unify most of the existing number theoretic based construction. And it simplifies a lot the proof for pseudorandom function, but also and especially for rigid key security. And using this, we are able to design new construction and we obtain